So, here's now the theorem which tells us how we decide whether a symmetric operator is self-adjoint, at least theoretically. And yeah, let me write it down here. So that's the basic criterion for self-adjointness. Self-adjointness, and this will be for self-adjoint. Later we will then see what we can get from this for essentially self-adjoint operators. Huh? But for theoretical purposes, of course, the self-adjoint case is the nicest. So what we have is our operator T defined on its domain, and we assume it's symmetric. So this should be symmetric. But now we want to understand how can we decide whether it's self-adjoint. And for this, we have a few equivalent statements. So the following are equivalent. So the first, of course, is what we want, namely T is self-adjoint. Then the second condition is a condition about the kernel eigenvalues of some operator, but not of T, but of T star. Because T is only symmetric and not yet self-adjoint, if we don't know one yet, then of course we have to distinguish between T and T star, and the statement here is about a T star. So first of all, okay, first is a property of T, namely it should be closed. T is closed. Yeah, I mean we know a symmetric operator is closable, but now if it is self-adjoint, essentially it really should be closed. And yeah, we have that the kernel of T star plus I, this is square root of minus 1, should be 0. So this means that T star has minus 1 not as its eigenvalue, and we need two conditions here, that it also has plus I not as its eigenvalue. So T star minus I, the kernel of this, is also equal to 0. Okay, and of course this is somehow what you are used from matrices, let's say. If you have a symmetric or self-adjoint matrix, symmetric and self-adjoint is the same there, then of course the eigenvalues should be all real. So in particular, plus and minus I should not be eigenvalues. And that's what we are essentially saying here, but in this context, but we have to distinguish between T and T star. And now we can also get a kind of dual version of this, which talks about the range. So this tells us essentially that this operator is injective, and now if we are going over to the range, then the question there is whether it's surjective or not, so whether the range is everything. And going between the kernel of an operator, the kernel and the range, we know that we can do this, but then we also go from T to T star. So in point 3, we have essentially a reformulation of this property in terms of the range, but not the range of T star, but the range of T. So here we are claiming the range of T minus I is everything, and also the range of T plus I is the whole Hilbert space. So if I take the adjoint of this operator, I'm getting this one. The adjoint of this is giving me this one, because the adjoint of plus I is minus I. And this is more or less this relation which you already have seen, that the kernel of T and the range of T star, or the other way around, are related by taking orthogonal complements. But we have to think a little bit more, so I will come back a little bit on this. But maybe just note, of course, what I'm saying, if I'm writing here T star plus I, or here, if I'm writing T plus I, of course with this, I mean T plus I times the identity operator. And this I, of course, is really the complex I, square root of minus 1. And if I'm taking sums of unbounded operators, of course, one always has to be careful. But here, this case, this is not a problematic case because T is unbounded, but the identity operator is, of course, a bounded operator. And the sum of an unbounded operator and a bounded operator, that's not a problem because the domain of this is just the domain of the unbounded operator. And of course also the adjoint of T plus I is just the adjoint of T plus the adjoint of I times identity, which is just minus I times identity. So this part doesn't really make problems with all those properties. So in particular, the domain of T plus I, of course, is just the domain of T, because this here is a bounded operator. Yeah, so I want to give a few parts of the proof. I'm not proving everything, but just maybe give you some aspects of it so that you see how it works. So all of those are more or less straightforward calculations, but it shows how the various things are connected to each other. And maybe let me start. So I'm proving 1 implies 2. And this is essentially the usual calculation which you do to show that a symmetric matrix has only real eigenvalues. So in particular, plus minus I cannot be eigenvalues. So we have to, it's this calculation by taking into account everything fits together nicely in terms of the domains. So let me prove 1 implies 2. Yeah, so I'm assuming that T is self-adjoint. In particular, okay, so I'm assuming T is equal to T star. And you see in 2 I'm claiming 2 things, the stuff about the kernel and also the fact that T is closed. But this is trivial if I assume that T is equal to T star, because T star is always closed. That was one point, the adjoint of an operator is always a closed operator. So and if T is equal to T star, this means T is closed. So a self-adjoint operator in particular must be closed. A symmetric operator is closable, but a self-adjoint one, of course, is closed. And now I want to show that those kernels are just trivial. So let me just look on one of them, or maybe let me look on both of them at the same time by just looking on T star, let's say, minus lambda. And lambda is plus minus I. Or maybe just any complex number which is not just a real number. So I consider a lambda, complex but not real. For example, for those two cases, so lambda would be plus and minus I. And then I want to show that this lambda cannot be an eigenvalue for T star. So then we have to show that the kernel of T star minus lambda is trivial, consists just of the zero vector, so which means that T star has lambda not as its eigenvalue. Yeah, so assume that I have an element in this kernel. So let me assume I have an X. Of course, to be in a kernel, it must, of course, be in the domain of the operator. So it should be in the domain of this operator, T star minus lambda. But this, of course, the domain is the same as the domain of T star, because this is just a shift by a bounded operator, which doesn't affect the domain. And of course, because we have assumed that T is equal to T star, this is also the same as the domain of T. Okay, and then, so I want this X, this should be in the kernel, so it should be in the domain, and kernel means if I apply this operator to it, I get 0. So what I assume here is that T star minus lambda applied to X is equal to 0. Or, of course, this here is the same as T minus lambda, because T star is equal to T. Because we have assumed that T star is equal to T, we really can, essentially for this part of the proof, getting rid of T and just work with T. So essentially we are showing here that T cannot have lambda as its eigenvalue. So what I have here is that T of X is equal to lambda of X. So Tx minus lambda x is equal to 0, or Tx is lambda x, or the Tx, of course, is the same as the T star x. Good. So we have here that this is the eigenvalue. And now we want to see that this cannot be. And how do we do this? Just by working in the inner product and moving the T from one side to the other, and then using the fact that the inner product is linear in one argument and antilinear in the other. Yeah, so let me do this explicitly. So what I'm looking at is, let's say, lambda bar times the inner product of xx. I want to show that x has to be equal to 0. Yeah, I'm looking on this. So lambda bar, lambda is a complex number. I can bring it in. Let's say I bring it into the first argument here. And our inner product is antilinear there. So it just gets in as a lambda, lambda x, comma x. Then, of course, lambda x is the same as tx. So this is tx, comma x. But now I can, because my operator is symmetric, or even self-adjoint here, I can bring the t to the other side. So I have here x, comma tx. Okay, and then, of course, the tx here, again, is lambda x. So what I have here is x, comma lambda x. But now I can take again out the x, the lambda. But the second argument is linear. So the inner product in the second argument is linear. So the lambda here comes out as a lambda, not as a lambda bar. So here I get lambda x, comma x. And now if lambda is not real, lambda and lambda bar are different, which means this equality can only be true if the inner product of x with itself is equal to 0. So if this guy here is equal to 0. Yeah. So since lambda is different from lambda bar, and of course different from 0, it follows that this guy here must be equal to 0. But if the inner product of a vector with itself is equal to 0, that means the norm of x is equal to 0. This implies, of course, that the vector itself must be equal to 0. So what we see here is that the kernel of t star minus lambda is equal to 0. Because if I take an x in this kernel, I have seen that it is equal to 0. And of course, 0 isn't the kernel of any linear operator. Yeah, okay, so this shows how I get from 1 to 2. And maybe let me now also show 2 to 3. I said this is more or less, or at least part of it, is just this relation between the range and the kernel of the operator and its adjoint. But this is only part of it, and maybe the other part is also quite interesting. Let us also talk about this. Yeah, but first let us do the easy case by using this relation between the range and the kernel. So I want to show that from this I get this. So I assume, and of course it's clear that somehow, this property here, the kernel of this, gives me the property of this range, and this kernel gives me this property. So I'm just going to show one of them. So I assume I have T is closed, and I assume that, let's say, this kernel is trivial. And then I want to see that this range here is everything. Yeah, so I assume that the kernel of T star plus the identity is 0. And then, I'm using this relation between the kernel of T star and the range of the operator. So this was our proposition, or theorem 3.11. From this we know that the range of T minus I, the orthogonal complement, this is the same as the kernel of the adjoint of the operator. So here my operator is T minus I. Joint of this and the kernel of this. So this was a general property for closable operators between the range and the kernel. Yeah, and of course, the star of this is T star plus I. So this is this one. So this is exactly this kernel, which by our assumption is equal to 0. So this here is T star plus I. And so you see, we get a property about this range, namely its orthogonal complement, is just consists of 0, And this means at least that this guy here must be dense. The problem is now that in general the range is not closed. So in general the range is not closed. So from this we cannot argue that the range is all of the Hilbert space, but we just get that it is dense. And we need an additional argument that it is closed, so that it is everything. And of course it's clear that the fact that our operator is closed will play a role for this. So what we get up to this point is that the range of T minus I is dense. In H. And so what we still have to show is that this range is closed. And ranges usually of our operators are not closed. So it's really, we need some special properties or some special situations to be able to show this. And here we have these properties. And also that the operator is closed in general, that's not good enough. I mean, there are many closed operators whose range is not closed. So it really depends on having more specific information. Yeah, but let us see how we get this in this case. So we have still to show, and that's maybe here the main part and the interesting part. So I want also to do this, that the range of T minus I is closed. Yeah, and for this, yeah, closed of course means that if I have a sequence there which converges to something, then this limit should also belong to this space. So I should take a sequence of elements in the range which converge to something, a priori just to something in H, in the Hilbert space, but then I have to show that the limit also belongs to this range. Yeah, so assume I have such a sequence, let me call it yn. So assume yn are elements which are all in the range of t minus I, and I assume this sequence converges to something, so yn converges to an element y in my Hilbert space, and then I have to show that this y is also in this range. Show is y is also in the range of t minus I. Good, of course. Okay, so the yn's are in the range of this operator, so this means the result of this operator applied to some elements, let's say yn. So I can write xn. So I can write the yn as t minus I xn. Yeah, and now, of course, the question is, what can I do? How could I get, of course, the idea would be that this xn also converges to something, and then, of course, this limit would be the canonical candidate for which y would be the image. But the question is, in general, if the elements here converge, there is no good reason why the pre-images should also converge. But here, there is a reason that here I'm not looking on operator T plus, but I'm adding something in an imaginary component, because this allows me to control somehow with the convergence of this, the convergence both of T of xn and xn itself. So why is this? So that's the crucial thing, why really such combinations of T with I or minus I are really relevant. So note the following, that if I have an element in the domain of this operator here, let's say T minus I, which of course is the same as the domain of T, then what happens if I calculate the norm of T minus I applied to this element set? Of course, the sets will later be the xn, but just look on this more general. So let us calculate this norm, and we do it with inner product, so it's better to take the square. So what is this? So the square of this norm, of course, is t minus I applied to set times t minus I applied to set. Yeah, now I just multiply this out. Of course, this is t set minus I times set, here the same, but then I use the bilinearity or cis collinearity of the inner product. So what do I get here? I get T set, then I get, let's say here, minus I set times T. The minus I comes out, but in the first component it comes out as the complex conjugate. So the I comes out as the minus I. With this minus, it comes out as a plus. So I get here a plus I times set, comma, and T I take T set. And then the other way around, I get here the T set and here the minus I set. Yeah, but here the minus I just comes out as a minus I, because there it's linear. So here I'm getting minus I, and here I have T set, comma, set. And then I get the last term, so I get a set, comma, set. And here I'm getting out the I, here the minus I. So together this gives a plus. So I'm getting also plus set, comma, set. Yeah, and now the nice feature of this is that those two terms, which are somehow the mixtures between set and T set, they cancel, because my operator is symmetric. So now I'm just using symmetric. I'm not using one. I'm not using that it's self-adjoint, but just the symmetry. But you see, this is okay because this element set is in the domain of my operator, and then I can bring T to the other side. So this and this is the same by the condition that my operator is symmetric. But here I have plus I, here I have minus I, so this is just zero. And that's, so this means I'm just left with those two terms, and the first, of course, is the norm of T set squared, and the second is the norm of set squared. And now you see this, that this combination of T and this I has a nice feature that if I apply this and I know something about the convergence of this guy, let's say to zero, then I get somehow two, I get as a statement that this has to go to zero and this has to go to zero. So I can control the convergence of both T applied to this guy and this guy itself. And that's exactly what we want to argue, that the xn here also have to converge to something. Yeah. So let us now apply this argument to our problem at hand, so namely to this, to showing that the range is closed, so applying it to the sequence of the yn's which we have. Look again at this situation. So we have yn's are in the range, and the yn's converge to something. So let me write it down again. So that's the situation which we're interested in, the yn's. These are t minus I applied to xn, and of this we assume that this converges to something, let's say a y. Yeah, but this means, of course, yeah, I assume convergence of this, and I want to show a convergence of something else, and to show a convergence, usually I should check that things are a Cauchy sequence. So I use here the fact that yn converges, which means it is a Cauchy sequence. So yn is a Cauchy sequence, so this means that I can control the distance between yn and ym if n and m are big enough. Yeah, but this I can now relate with other quantities. So let me write this down. So the yn, of course, is t minus I applied to xn, and the ym is t minus I applied to xm. So what I have here, this yn is t minus I xn, and this ym is t minus I xm. And now you see I'm exactly in this situation which I had here, and this set is now the difference between these x's. So from the calculation which I had here, I know that this is now the same as t, the t applied to those guys, xn minus xm squared plus the vector itself, but this is now xn minus xm squared. Yeah, good, but now if this is a Cauchy sequence, this means this goes to zero if n and m are big enough. This is as small as I want, but this means also this and this must be as small as I want. So in particular, this tells me that this here is a Cauchy sequence, and so that the this tells me that the Txn is a Cauchy sequence, and this tells me that the Xn itself is a Cauchy sequence, which means each of them converges. So because the Ys are a Cauchy sequence, from this argument, I can get that both the T of Xn and the Xn are a Cauchy sequence. So Txn is a Cauchy sequence in H, and Xn is also a Cauchy sequence in H. And because H is complete, this means both of them must converge to something. And of course, the relevant part is, of course, that the Xn converges to something. So I get a limit of the Xn. Yeah, so this means both converge. So let me call the limit here set. So there is an element set in H such that T of Xn converges to set. And there is an element, let me call it X, such that the Xn converge to X. Yeah, okay, and now, of course, what we want is that the Y should be my operator T minus I applied to this X, but this in particular means that the X should, of course, be in the domain of my operator T, because otherwise I cannot do this, and for this I need now the closedness, because now you see I'm exactly in the situation which I need, for a closed operator. So namely, if my x's converge to something and the t of xn converge also to something, then I know that the limit here is in the domain and that this guy must be the image of t applied to this guy. Yeah, so that's really where we need the fact that t is closed. Otherwise, it could be that I have here convergence to something, but this something is not in the domain of my operator T, and then I could not use this X for writing something in the range. But because T is closed, I get now from here that X is in the domain of my operator, and furthermore, that T of X is equal to this here. So we have this kind of continuity on the domain for closed operators. So you see, we can argue with continuity even if our operators are not bounded, because we have some kind of continuity, but just for nice situations in the domain. Yeah, and then we have more or less what we want, because now we can also see that T minus I applied to the Xn converges exactly to what it should, namely to T minus I times the X. So then we have, so the Y, what is the Y? The Y, we said this was the limit of the Yn's, and the Yn's were written as T minus I Xn. And of course, now we split this into the two parts of which we now know that they converge. So namely, this is T Xn minus I Xn. Yeah, but we have now seen that T of Xn converges to Z, and Xn converges to X, so this here converges to I times X. And of course, this set which I have here is actually the T of this X which I have here. So this limit here is really nothing else than Tx minus Ix, which is of course T minus Ix. So I have now really written my Y is an element T minus I X, which means Y is also in the range of T minus I. So this this here is in the range of t minus I. Okay, and so this proves 2 to 3, and of course to prove going from this kernel to this range is of course the same. Huh? I mean, going from there to there is you see it stands, and then to show that this here is everything, or this here is everything, is the same argument. You just replace plus minus I by plus I. Yeah, good. Okay, so this only proves part of the implications which we have to do here. So we still would have to do that from 3 follows 1. I mean, this is also calculation, which is maybe not just one line, so you have to work a little bit more, but it's of the same kind of nature. Huh? So you see, it's kind of simple calculations, and everything fits together nicely. Huh? So I'm not going to do this. Maybe you can do it by yourself. Huh? So this is a similar nature of this proof. Yeah, this I want to end the proof of this, and though we have this main basic description of what does it mean, at least theoretically, that a symmetric operator is self-adjoint. So how can we decide this? Huh? So it's saying that T star cannot have non-real eigenvalues, which of course maybe is a criterion which is, I'm not sure whether it's so useful, because to decide this, you would have to calculate T star. Huh? If you want to decide whether T is, you are given an operator T which is symmetric and you have its domain. Okay, of course you can check very usually, whether you have, let's say, complex eigenvalues, you have eigenvectors in this domain. But here, of course, you have to see that you don't have eigenvectors in the domain of T star. And which means you should calculate the domain of T star, which is more or less the same as having to calculate whether T is equal to T star. So maybe from a practical purpose, this condition looks nice, but maybe it's not really easier than just checking directly that T is equal to T star. Here on the other hand, I mean, this is about T itself. So if you can see somehow that the range of T plus I is everything, then you are done. So this might be something which is easier to check directly, because for this you don't have to invoke T star, you just have to work on the domain of T, which you are usually given. Yeah, good. Okay, but we will look a little bit more into this, what we can get out of this.